how to reduce these three parameters individually.
Okay. So today what I'll do is I'll go over some discrete topics related to memory systems before we move on to our discussion on DRAM. So this one we discussed last time a little bit about exclusive hierarchy. So essentially here we're talking about two levels on board. Levels of the cache hierarchy which are exclusive. And the reason for this was that inclusion has a couple of drawbacks, right? So one is that there is replication across levels of hierarchy because you maintain inclusion. So that if you have two levels of cache, L1 and L2, then L1 would be a subset of L2, which means necessarily there will be wastage of space on the level of replication. The second problem is that when you evict a block from the outer level cache, when you evict a block from here, you have to inherit the block in L1 also, maintain it, because otherwise L1 may not remain a subset of L2. Now, it's a little problematic because you're essentially taking away a block from L1 cache simply because you are evicting something from L2 cache, okay? But it may very well happen that the block in the L1 cache is heavily used by the processor. So if you examine it a little more carefully, what is going to happen is that, consider a cache block which is very heavily used by the processor. So what will happen? The processor pipeline is here, and it will essentially access the block from L1. It will have several hits, which the L2 will not get to know, because we do not really access L2 if I get the block in L1. Okay. So what will happen? What may happen is that this block may eventually become the LRU block in L2 set, because there is no access seen by L2 cache, so it may become the least recent used block. And eventually the L2 cache may actually evict the block, because it's the LRU block. Okay. And when it evicts the block, to maintain inclusion, it will also inherit the block from L1, which may actually hurt performance, because actually this is a very hot block being accessed by the processor. Okay. So these are called back invalidations, invalidations triggered by L2 eviction. Okay. So what will happen when you evict such a block? Immediately the processor will actually access the block, have a cache miss, and bring the block back again to L2, L2 and L1. And this cycle will keep on repeating. Again, it will access the block from L1. L2 will think that this is a cold block. It will become LRU eventually, and then again evict it. So ultimately what will happen is that because of the back invalidations, you'll see extra cache misses coming up, which you wouldn't have if you had not had to worry about inclusion. So these are called back invalidations, or sometimes called inclusion overhead. Just because of inclusion, you are introducing these extra cache misses. Is that clear? If you have an exclusive hierarchy, this problem goes away, both of the problems actually. Okay. You don't have any duplication across levels, and you don't have to worry about this back invalidation. Whenever you evict a block from L2, you can just evict it, because there is no guarantee about the subset. All you have to make sure that these are exclusive in the disjoint. So whenever a block is in L2, it's not in L1, you know that. So if you evict a block from L2, you can just evict it without modifying it. So what is the trade-off between inclusion and exclusion? This one also we discussed last time, that exclusion buys you capacity because there is a duplication. But it requires more bandwidth, because whenever a block gets evicted from L1, it has to be allocated to L2. So it has to traverse the bus or interconnect, whatever that is, between L1 and L2, and it will go to L2 and get allocated on every eviction from L1, which is not present in inclusion. Now, it is possible to make exclusive caches bandwidth efficient. Essentially, the idea is that when you evict a block from L1, you put a pattern larder here, okay, which will monitor the blocks that are getting evicted from L1, and basically figure out which blocks are not likely to be reused in the future. And those blocks will not actually go to L2. They will just be dropped, okay, because there's no point keeping these blocks in the cache area. So I'm not going to detail of this particular gadget setting here. You can essentially the idea is that you monitor the accesses inside L1 of this box, and based on that you decide whether the block is dead or maybe lying in the future. Now there's a middle ground that often processors take that's called non-inclusive, non-exclusive. What is that? Essentially the idea is that your L1 is not a subset of L2, but it's not also disjoint. So what happens in this case is that when you bring a block from memory, you fill it to L2, fill it to L1, both. But when you evict something from L2, you don't inherit the block from L1. So essentially what I'm doing is that I'm taking away this part of the problem, this back invalidations. I still have a window where the blocks are duplicated across the levels of the hierarchy. So when you evict a block from L2, you don't modify about L1. And this is where the subset property gets violated. So essentially what you get is neither exclusive nor inclusive. Okay, so as I said, I'll essentially go through some of the discrete topics today. The second one is trace cache. This is used in Intel processors. It was introduced in Pentium 4. Essentially the idea was that you need to supply good instructions quickly into the pipeline. By good instructions, I mean almost always, you want to remain on the correct path. Right? So you have to make correct branch predictions, and you want to remain on the correct path. Because if you are not, then you are essentially processing instructions which will be eventually thrown away. You're wasting time. So, of course, one way to achieve this is to have smart branch predictors. Another way is to have a trace cache. So what is this? So often predicted target of a branch falls in a different cache box and maybe in the middle of a block. So this one also we talked about last time. So essentially, you're currently executing an instruction in this particular cache block. And let's suppose you have a branch instruction somewhere here. And the target of this instruction falls in the middle of some other cache block. Right? So you execute this instruction, and the next instruction executed will be this one. So clearly, this part of the cache block is going to be wasted. So it wastes the trailing part of the cache block having the branch, this part. It wastes the header part of the target cache block, this part. And the worst part is that you cannot fetch from the target in the same cycle, even if the prediction is correct. So the simple reason is that you usually fetch from a single cache block in a particular cycle. You cannot really fetch from multiple cache blocks in a cycle. You can have multi-ported instruction caches, so we'll soon talk about multi-ported caches. But normally it's very hard to design at high frequency because additional ports usually slow down memory structures. So what Pentium 4 did was, it built traces dynamically. So the branch prediction validation becomes part of the hit test. So what it does is that, on the fly, whenever you have a branch instruction, like this one, you find the target, all right, and you prepare a trace of instructions where this particular instruction appears right after this instruction. So essentially now you are preparing a trace cache block where this instruction appears right after this instruction. You're preparing these traces on the fly as and when you encounter these branches and targets. So it was introduced in Pentium 4, which did not have an L1 instruction cache, but only had a trace cache. And while building the trace lines, Pentium 4 also translates the IA32 instructions to micro operations, which is of the critical path so that it actually saves a lot of decoding time there. So is the idea clear what's happening? So I'm executing like this. I have a branch. So then I jump here. And then I again execute like this. Maybe I encounter one more branch here. Then I jump to some other cache block with the target here. So what will happen is that what will the trace have? So let's mark these ones. This portion is A. This is B. this instruction is C, this portion is D, this is E, this is F, okay, and so on. So a trace will have A, B, C, D, E, F, etc. Okay. So the trace will not have this part. Okay. It will be dropped completely. And this trace will be prepared on the fly. And this will basically become a trace cache block. And that will be stored in your trace cache. So next time, whenever you encounter A, you will get out this whole cache block out. Okay. But however, now the question is, next time when I encounter B, will it go to C again? That may not be the case actually. It may go to some other place. For example, it may be actually go in this direction through the fall through path. Okay, right? So that's the point here. Branch prediction validation becomes part of the hit test. So the a trace cache lock not only checks the tag of the block, but it also checks the branch predictions that are embedded inside the trace. Okay. They also have to match. Otherwise, the trace line will be rejected, and it will actually fall back to the traditional execution. Okay. Is the concept clear? What a trace cache is? Now, one major problem of trace cache was that it may contain duplicate partial traces. Why is that? How do you get duplicate partial traces? So the same piece of code may be part of two different paths, right? You can execute through this path. You can execute through this path, and you can have a common portion of both of these traces. Okay. So they may appear as two different trace lines, two different portions of the trace cache. Okay. So this is really very hard to avoid. It's extremely hard actually to avoid duplicate partial traces. Anyway, so I'll keep it to that only. If you really want to delve deeper into trace cache, let me know. I can give you a paper which talks about it. Also, if you want to know more about exact architecture of the Pentium 4 trace cache, let me know. I'll give you a paper.
Sir,
yeah.
When is the trace cache looked? So at fetch time?
Yes.
At time of the instruction fetch. So if it misses in the trace cache, only then the instruction cache would be accessed?
That's right. So interestingly, Pentium 4 did not have an L1 instruction cache. It would access the L2 cache actually in that case. Yeah. Exactly.
And sir, what about self-modifying applications? So the traces would have to be
flushed out of the cache. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. Any other question? Okay. All right. So we discussed a little bit about multi-ported cache here. So let me try to offer some more detail here. So what is a multi-ported cache? Essentially, the idea is very simple. You want to support multiple accesses to the cache in the same cycle. So essentially, you want to have multiple parallel accesses to the cache. Okay. How do you do that? You need one port per access. That's the whole point. So that I can access, for example, if I have a dual-ported cache, I may be able to access two different cache blocks in the same cycle, concurrently. So instruction caches are normally not multi-ported. So then the question is, how can I fetch multiple instructions every cycle? Because we say that this is one important aspect of a superscalar processor. Okay. So one simple solution is that you have multiple instructions in a cache block. So you can just bring one cache block, and hopefully you'll have many instructions within the cache block. Right? If you really want to have the effect of a multi-ported cache, at least to some extent, you can have a band interleaved cache. For example, if you have two separate banks of the instruction cache, you can access both the banks in parallel. And you can make each bank single port without any problem. So that will still give you some benefit, but it won't give you the full freedom. Because for example, if you find that you want to access two cache blocks falling on the same bank, that will not be allowed. Which would be allowed in a true dual-ported cache. Right? So that's what you lose actually. So to the external world, a bank interleaved cache more or less looks like a multi-ported cache, but memory cells are actually not multi-ported. So they are just single-ported. You have a bunch of single-ported banks. That's all. So you can get some amount of concurrency, but not full concurrency. So that's about instruction cache. The question is now, do we need multiple data cache accesses per cycle?
And the answer is normally yes, because memory is the bottleneck. So it always helps to have multiple concurrent accesses going to the data cache. Okay. So it's good to have better data cache throughput. So normally you'd find that data caches are dual ported, at most dual ported. Normally they're not, they do not have more than two ports. This one we have already discussed. So what does a store do when it issues? So I'm not going to get into that. You might want to remind yourself. That's why this question is here. Okay, so that's about multi-ported caches. So keep in mind that instruction caches are normally not multi-ported. We'll revisit this question again when discussing high-port threading. That will pick up after the break. So there we'll see another motivation of having multi-ported instruction caches, and we'll see how to circumvent that. Data caches are normally multi-ported, but number of ports is small. Okay, so a little bit about input-output. So I'm just trying to touch upon a few things that interact with the memory hierarchy. We haven't yet discussed I/O, but I assume that all of you have seen at least some of I/O, input-output. So essentially, the point here is that the peripheral devices that the computer talks to, essentially the input-output devices, like your keyboard, your display device, your printers, CD-ROM drives, USB drives, speakers, etc., right? So the question now is, the question that I'm trying to ask here is as follows. So let me give you an example. Suppose I'm reading in some input from a keyboard. So the user is typing in certain things. So how does it work? Usually, the data that is being keyed in will be stored in the keyboard controller, which is a small buffer. And when the buffer gets full, it will send an interrupt to the CPU. So the CPU then picks up the data, copies the data from the keyboard's internal buffer into the memory, right? Okay. So the question now is that it copies it into the memory or to the cache. Where does the data go? So once the data has been copied, now the CPU can work on the data. It can parse the data. It can interpret the data in whatever way it wants, okay? Whatever way the program wants. So for example, when you say scanf %d ampersand x, right? So what does it do? It reads in an integer, puts the value at that particular address, whatever is specified there, right? The question is this address cacheable or not? Does it go to the cache or does it not? Because next, what I may want to do is, I may say that x plus plus, right? That's a CPU instruction, and x will be copied into the cache, and you operate it on, right? Okay. So this particular buffer, so essentially there are two copies that are going on, first of all. Scanf will involve a system call, which the operating system will copy the data from your keyboard buffer into kernel space buffer, right? And then the kernel space buffer would be copied to this particular address, okay, the content of that buffer. The question is, where is the kernel space buffer? Is it inside the cache or not? What do you think? Because this address is, of course, in the user space. This will be cacheable. It's an arbitrary address. Okay. Where is the kernel space buffer? What does the intuition tell you? Is it cached or not? The buffer used for doing I/O.
If we use x just after, maybe it's better to put it in the cache.
Sorry, second?
If we use x just after?
No, so ampersand x is a user space address.
Yeah.
So it is, of course, cacheable. It will be inside the cache. The question is, so there is an intermediate copy that is going on, right? You copy the data from keyboard buffer into a kernel space buffer. That's the I/O buffer. And then the kernel space buffer's contents will be copied to that particular address. And that completes scanf. The question is, where is this intermediate buffer? Is it inside the cache or is it not in the cache?
It has to be in cache.
Why?
There is no way you can avoid cache.
cluster is reading certain address as two terms.
What if I mark this particular page as uncacheable? I can do that, right? You can do that.
Hardware knows what to cache program.
Hardware doesn't know, but the operating system knows. Operating system may choose to make the IO buffer uncacheable. So it can generate a TLB translation where the attribute bits will say that this is an uncacheable page. That's possible. What do you lose by that? If I make it uncacheable? It's going to take a long time. Exactly. So here I'm talking about a single variable, but you may take a bunch of inputs. For example, you may be reading from a file. So that will take a long time to copy from the kernel space to the user space. So normally the kernel space buffers are cacheable. So now that leads to a big problem. So after a while, suppose I do, so I'm fine, I'm happy, I've read X. I continue, then after a while I say scanf ampersand D and Y. Okay. Right? Okay. So so remember that the kernel space buffer is now cached, right? Okay. So when I do the input, it's going to query cache hit, right? It's already in the cache. The problem is that now when I try to read Y, I may actually get a stale value because X may get copied to Y from the old kernel space buffer, the copy that is inside the cache. Okay. So this is called a coherence problem. So that's what is being summarized here.
There must be input queues, right? The data will come into a stream.
Yeah.
When you read from the head of the stream.
Right.
So
okay.
Once you read, the stream will go to the next element.
No, but the stream contents will be copied into an internal kernel space buffer, right? For processing.
So this buffer must be written before. So there is a copy from the keyboard controller to the kernel space.
That's right.
So that must have, that must execute before this scan.
That's right. Yes.
So okay. It must update the buffer also.
Right, exactly. So that's exactly what is being said here. IO through cache poses no correctness issues. Okay, but may hurt performance. So essentially the point here is that when you put the buffer in cache, as he has already mentioned, there will be an IO space, there will be a kernel space right to this buffer, which is already cached. So when the processor will try to copy from that buffer, it will get the correct contents and put the value in the address of Y. Okay. But direct IO to memory may leave stale data in cache. Okay. So here the point is that, consider this one here. Okay. Suppose the buffer actually was in memory. Okay. It was not cached. But processor has to copy X from the buffer. Okay. So what does it do in the process? It will actually cache the buffer because what will it generate? What kind of instructions? It will say load some certain address from the buffer space, and then store that value into this particular address. So there will be a pair of load and store, and the load will go to the cache, of course. All right. So the point is that what you have done is that you have essentially copied the buffer into the cache from memory, and then when you do this I/O. As I said, suppose the IO happens directly to memory. So kernel will actually copy the keyboard buffer contents directly to memory buffer, okay, without modifying the cache. Another processor again does the same process. It starts copying from the kernel space buffer to this address. But now it's going to take a cache hit, right? So okay, let me show you, so this is my memory area. This is the cache. So let's talk about the first scan. Right. So let's talk about this one first. Direct IO to memory. So what does the kernel do? Kernel copies the keyboard controller's buffer contents into memory. Let's suppose this is my input buffer. Okay. Here it puts the data
processor keyboard controller buffer
into this.
Okay, then the processor's job. So now the system call handler essentially has done its job. It has read from the keyboard into the kernel space buffer. Now the processor has to copy the content of this buffer into that particular address, %x, whatever that is. So what does it do? It will generate a bunch of instructions, two of which the most important ones would be a load word, which will load from this address into some register. So address underscore IBM colon. Alright? Okay. And then what it will do? It will do store word $2 into address of x. Okay. That completes the first scan. Alright? So what is the effect of this? Essentially, by these two instructions, I have done two things. I have made a copy of address IP inside my cache, the cache block containing that. And I have made a copy of address X inside my cache. Okay. Now the second scanf happens. Alright, so what does the kernel do? It reads the keyboard controller's buffer, copies the contents into here. Remember that I am doing direct I/O to memory. Alright? And the system call handler's job completes it. Now what does the processor do? Processor has to copy these contents into %y.
Okay.
So it starts the process again. It does exactly the same thing, except that this will now be y. So now what is going to happen? As soon as it executes this instruction, it will get a cache hit. Okay. Whatever the value is here will be loaded into $2, which is actually a wrong value. Right? And then it will execute this store. So essentially address Y will get the value of X, whatever the value of X is. The actual contents are actually still here, sitting here. So is the problem here? The direct I/O to memory may leave stale data in cache. On the other hand, if the I/O actually happened through the cache, then this problem would arise actually, because the kernel space input buffer would actually be cacheable here.
Okay.
I'll always get the correct content from the cache. I won't be making two different copies.
It's divided as is processor cache also.
They can. You can make the I/O device access the cache. But actually, to solve this problem, if you actually choose to do this, eventually you have to do that in a different way. Because if you say that, well, I don't allow my I/O devices to interfere with the processor caches, but then you have to come up with a solution for this. Okay. So how do you solve this? So here are a couple of solutions for direct memory I/O. The syscall handler must ensure that cache lines belonging to the input buffer space are flushed to memory before starting the I/O. Right? So essentially what I'm saying is that this particular cache line should be flushed from the cache before the input output operation starts. Okay. So processors come with privileged, selective, or full cache flush instructions. So you can make use of them to do this. The second solution is that hardware must check if some I/O device is reading or writing to a memory line that is currently cached. So this one requires some extra hardware support. That is, whatever address that flows between the I/O device and memory must be snooped by the processor cache. And if it finds that that particular address is currently cached, it has to remove that cache block.
Okay.
If yes, the cache line must be invalidated in the entire cache hierarchy and written back in case it is done. So this is very attractive to the operating system designers because it doesn't interfere with the processor cache.
Okay.
I/O does not interfere with processor caches. Because there are many many pieces of data that the processor cache should not have,
okay.
Many kernel space data. But that can be avoided completely if you do I/O in memory. But the downside of that is that you have to do this, guarantee the correctness. Same problem, so I have given an example of input here. Same problem can arise in output also. Exact same problem. You may end up printing on the display device something which you did not want to print actually. Some old data you may end up printing. So we'll soon pick up input output in more detail. So there again we'll come back to this problem with more examples hopefully. So any question on this? Is this clear? So here the takeaway point is that even in a single processor system, you have to worry about the problem of cache coherence, which people often talk about in context of multiprocessors. Okay. But even on single processors, you have to support some minimal amount of cache coherence to be able to do I/O correctly. Because the I/O devices can be seen as individual processor entities. So essentially, now you have a main processor, you have certain other I/O devices that can independently manipulate data. So you have to have some solution for coherency. Question?
By default, it is cacheable.
You can make it either way. So it depends on the operating system actually. It varies. Exactly which kernel data is cacheable, which is not. So usually that comes as part of your page table attribute. Page table will say whether this can be cached or not. Okay, so I wanted to touch upon multi-level paging a little bit. How many of you have seen this from your operating system course? Okay, right. Multi-level paging, so that's good. So I'll just quickly go over this since I discussed paging. So there is a problem with handling large page tables. So let's try to understand what the problem is. In alpha 2.1 to 6.4, so this example is taken directly from your book. So you can go back and read in more detail. This is just a summary of that. So alpha 2.1 to 6.4 implements segmented paging, but we're going to ignore that part. We'll assume it's a flat paging scheme. It has 8 kilobyte page size, which means it's a 13-bit page offset. Right? Each page table entry is 8 bytes wide. So it has a 32-bit virtual page number, so that gives you a 43-bit virtual address. Actually, it is more. The upper bits are reserved for some other purposes, segment number and all those things. So a segment is normally page in upper modes. The upper bits specify segment ID. So anyway, so for our purpose, what is important is that we have 30-bit virtual page number. All right. So with 8-byte page table entries, this leads to an 8 gigabyte page table. 2 to the power of 30 multiplied by 8. It's gigantic. So you can imagine, just to support virtual memory, you have to devote 8 gigabyte of memory space for storing the page table, which doesn't make any sense. So you cannot hold the entire page table in memory. What you do is you must swap in and out page table sections. Okay. So what you do is you page the page table. So simple solution is to treat the page table as normal memory and page them also. So 2.1 to 6.4 provides 3 levels of page tables. Page table base register holds the base address of N1 page table. Each level can access 1024 page table entries. So this is what it looks like. Thirteen bits of page offset. So that gives you 43 bits of virtual address, right? Okay. So each of these point to the levels of your tables. So the page table base register holds the base address of your L1 page table. Okay. So each of the tables can hold 1024 page table entries. So essentially, these 10 bits would tell you where in L1 I should index. Okay, all right. So what does this entry tell you? Any guess? Okay, here it's not there. What should this entry hold? What do I need to know? To continue the process.
The page table for the next 10 bits.
The base address of the page table. the base of L2. This one tells me the offset into it. This one holds the base of L3. What does this one contain?
Base address of the page.
Base address of the page. The physical page number, right?
This
is a page table entry, right? Okay. All right. So that's how you access. So essentially, all you need to do is you need to keep these three tables in your memory. How big are they? Each one contains 1024 page table entries. Each page table entry is how much?
8 bytes.
So how big are these tables?
8 into 10.
Yeah?
8 kilobytes.
8 kilobytes. How much is that? A page. So I just need to hold three pages. That's it. So usually the page tables are sized in such a way that they become a page. They're just a page. So at any point in time, you have to hold one page of each of these three levels. That's all. Instead of holding 8 gigabyte of page table, you just need to hold three pages. Okay. Now, Alpha 2164 is a 64-bit processor. This only gives you 43 bits of the virtual address. What about the upper 21 bits? So remaining 21 bits of the virtual address are used to identify the segment. It supports three segments, so there are many unused bits towards the end. Okay. The three segments need to be identified using 21 bits. So you can read up about this example in your book. So it has more details about Alpha 2164 virtual memory. Okay, so now we'll switch a little bit. So we're essentially moving a little bit out of the processor. And we'll take a look at main memory. All right. So what they look like. So the outermost level of the cache hierarchy talks to main memory on a cache miss. Right? So for example, if I have an L1 and L2, only on an L2 miss, I'll talk to the main memory. Otherwise, I'm happy with my cache hierarchy. I can get the data from the cache hierarchy. And of course, the I/O devices may have a separate path to main memory. Now, the interface to memory is normally through a memory controller. Memory controller is connected to the bus interface unit, which in turn connects the system bus, also used to be known as front side bus, to the outermost cache controller. All right, so let's suppose that this is my L3 cache. I have L2 and L1 before it, and this is my memory controller, and this is my main memory. And the L3 controller talks to the memory controller. There may be other paths through which the I/O devices talk to the memory controller. All right. So this is the bus which connects the L3 and the memory controller. The cache controller, that is the L3 cache controller, usually puts a request in a buffer, and the bus interface unit grants the bus to that request at some point. So talking about this particular bus here. So there's a queue here where L3 will put the requests, and eventually the request will be picked up by the bus interface unit and usually carries out an arbitration algorithm among various types of buffers connecting the memory controller and cache controller. For example, there will be a queue for cache misses, there will be a queue for evicted cache blocks, so there may be some many other queues depending on the interface. The request ultimately gets queued into the memory controller input queue. So this request ultimately gets transferred to a queue here. All right. And the memory controller's job is to decode the request and take appropriate action. So you can think about this memory controller as a very simple processor. It essentially picks up requests from this queue, decodes it, figures out the address, figures out the command type, and launches the request to the main memory, depending on that. Okay. So here are the steps involved in solving a cache miss from outermost level beyond the miss detection. So you queue the miss request in BIU buffer. So this is a BIU buffer, bus interface unit buffer. So how many request types, and hence how many different logical queues? So that depends very much on your architecture, but you can assume that there will be one queue, one request type for cache misses, and one request type for evicted cache misses. There will be at least two for sure. The bus interface unit schedules the request and switches the address, control, and data according to the bus protocol. Okay, so essentially, when it picks up a request from here, it will launch the address on this bus. It will launch whatever control that is needed, that is command type and request type. If it's an evicted cache block, there will be data also associated with it, which will be written back to memory. Right? The request is filled in at the other end by the memory controller and is put in a queue. So this queue. The memory controller picks the requests out of this queue, normally in order. There is no out of order scheduling going on here. Decodes request type and address and sends it to the DRAM, that is your dynamic random access memory. So this is the DRAM. The DRAM access involves decoding row, decoding column, and reading out data lumped together as the access time. So DRAM is actually arranged as a two-dimensional matrix of bits. So there is a row ID, there is a column ID, and at the intersection point, whatever the data is, that's what you're trying to access. Right? So that's what is meant by decoding row, decoding column, and reading out the data. The data reply is filled by the memory controller. So eventually, the reply will come back to the memory controller. It will be filled in by the memory controller. And put in the bus interface queue for scheduling. So there will be a queue on this side also. So that will go in, eventually be scheduled, and the processor, the L3 cache controller will be notified that the data has arrived. Right? So this particular bus is often called a channel that connects the memory controller to the DRAM. So there are two important parameters when you talk about main memory, latency and bandwidth. So latency essentially is the time taken from the address and command is sent to the DRAM to the time the memory controller gets the data back. Okay, that's the latency of one access. And the bandwidth is essentially how fast was the data, when the first data comes out, how fast can you send out the remaining pieces of data. So for example, when you talk about a cache block, let's assume that you have a 64-byte cache block. Typically, the DRAM interface would be 64 bits. So this particular bus, this channel would be, for example, 64-bit wide. Typically, that is the case. Right? Which means to transfer a 64-byte cache block will require 8 transactions over the bus. Right? So the point is that if you had a wider bus, you could actually reduce the transfer number of transfers. Okay. That's what the bandwidth is. So once you have read the data, how fast can you transfer it to the memory controller? That's terrible. Now there are typically two types of applications when you look at the software programs. One class is called compute bound, where given a particular data point, you do a lot of computations. So these are compute bound applications. And typically in these processors, you don't require much memory bandwidth. Because given a data point, the program will spend a lot of time operating on the data. Okay, so essentially, the requests will be spaced out to memory. Whereas in memory-bound applications, you typically do small amounts of computation on each data point and then require a large amount of data. So they will be very much bandwidth-bound by memory. Like, so here, this category typically contains game-like applications, where you have a lot of data that are needed to be transferred from the memory to the graphics processor. So similarly, there are other classifications like latency bound applications and bandwidth bound applications. Similarly, you can define that. The applications, so these applications would not ask for too much of data, but when they ask, it's always needed to respond very quickly. Otherwise, their performance may get affected. So these are called latency bound applications. Whereas bandwidth-bound applications would ask for a lot of data,
in a very short span. So, so in their case, the bandwidth is more important than latency. So it's easy to improve bandwidth. For example, you can have wide memory and bus. You could have interleaved banking in memory so that you can access multiple banks in parallel. Or you could have a smart scheduler at this queue. Okay, you could actually figure out, so we'll talk about some of the scheduling algorithms very soon, which requests should be scheduled early. Okay, right? So if you have memory banks, your goal should be to utilize as many banks as possible. Okay. So you should not be scheduling requests which go to the same bank at the same time, because they cannot be serviced in parallel. They will be serviced one after another. Okay. So the question is, how many banks to support? Is there a relationship with access latency? If I tell you that one request requires n cycles, how many banks should I support? Is there a relationship at all? Yeah? What if I have n banks? Do I need more than n banks if one request requires n cycles? So if I have n banks, every cycle I can send a request to a different bank, right? Potentially, if I have a request for every bank available. Right? Okay. So, but this relationship is not very useful because usually the access time is very large. You cannot cover that by having as many banks. Because today, high-density DRAM integration points to small number of banks. Okay, that's what today's DRAM architectures are. There are 4 to 8 banks, not more than that. Okay. So you have to deal with this particular problem, fan conflict. So you have to have a scheduler which should not try to pick requests conflicting in the bank. So the goal of the scheduler should be to pick up requests going to independent banks, okay. Which means you may not be able to do in-order scheduling anymore. You may have to skip over requests and look for requests that go to independent banks. So typically today what happens is that this particular queue will actually get scattered into queues for each bank. So memory control will pick up a request, decode the request, find out the bank number, and put it in the corresponding bank queue. Right? And then it's up to the bank controller to schedule the request one after another from the bank queue. So how to improve latency? There are architectural techniques, mostly revolves around hiding techniques. That is, we have talked about many of these already. For example, one is prefaging. You try to preface to hide the latency of the DRAM. Alright? There are lower level techniques that try to improve latency, but they deal with DRAM technology, which we will not cover in this course. But there are techniques which can improve latency with technology improvements.